Hello everyone, welcome to today's live stream. This is the first live stream that's geared more towards one of the workshop seminars where we're actually going to be building a Kumiko panel. So today I'm going to be working with Norman Pirollo. Actually, Norman's going to be showing me and instructing us how to build such beautiful pieces. It's going to be a four-part, this is the first of four parts, and today we're going to get started, and then once after the fourth session, even I will have made something like this. So Norman has proven to me and guaranteed that I'm going to be able to do this, so I'm looking forward to learning. So before we really do get started, we're going to take a look and see where everyone's logging in from, and we'll get started, let the group build a little bit, and then Norman will take it away, and we will start. So we've got a couple people logging in here already, which is fantastic. So you can see these panels that Norman has pre-built are absolutely stunning, and he has assured that that this isn't even too far for me to do. So very excited. So hello Lawrence and Michael, this is amazing. I can see some names there. Oh, one Joe from Texas. Holy, lots of people are signing, and this is fantastic. So it looks like we will, as people kind of progress here, we will get started. We've got our time set for about 45 minutes, but if we do happen to run a little bit further, that's fine too. Any questions you might have, please feel free to ask us. We'll get back to you right away. I know Norman has also prepared a bit of a presentation as well, so at some point the video will show a presentation happening. And once the presentation's done, if you happen to have any questions, we'll get back to the questions. So welcome, Norman.
Thank you, Matt. Okay, I'll introduce myself. I'm a furniture designer maker, and I've been at this for a couple of decades and more now. Try not to make that sound too long. And in the last 2 years, a little over two years ago, I was introduced to Kumiko, and took it on as a challenge because I found it intimidating to be able to work with small pieces, and I love challenges. I mean, my whole career has been based on challenging myself. So I took on Kumiko and just wanted to learn, see if I could tackle it. And I was surprised to find out that it wasn't as intimidating as I thought. And it was far simpler than I thought. And once you get the hang of it, it's just a matter of reproducing pieces. And I'll give you an idea. This is what we're going to be doing in the workshop. It's an Asanoa pattern. And this one hasn't been completed, but you can see the parts are replicated in each of the four squares. So once you've done one, once you've created the outside grid and created the inner components, then it's just a matter of replicating this for this pattern.
So Norman, for people who aren't familiar with the Kumiko patterns like this, are those pieces glued in place?
The outside grid should have adapted glue, and that's only because if you're mounting it in a piece of furniture or a wall panel,
okay,
it keeps people might press on it. And it depends on the application. If it's if you're not installing it in a door or something, then you probably don't have to glue it. These are not glued.
Okay.
But I would recommend just a dab of glue between the joints and then fit them in. It causes the joints to slide in a little easier too.
Okay.
And then you don't actually see the glue. This is white glue I've used. Now just to go further, that's an Asanoa pattern, but this is the Yatsuba Itsutsu Tsugi pattern. It's also popular. And just to describe how, once you get the hang of it, it's just a matter of, you've got the grid, and it's just a matter of filling in with this pattern. It's a rectangle with locking keys. So I just wanted to show that there are literally hundreds of patterns, and I'll get into that shortly. But this is the Asanoa snowflake, or it's called, Asanoa is a Japanese term for a hemp leaf. So it actually resembles a hemp leaf. And so I've taken that on, and I'm far more comfortable now than I ever was with Kumiko. And it's a nice way of developing your hand tool skills, specifically using chisels and using small tools like a dazuki or a small fine-tooth backsaw. And you'll appreciate hand tools far more than. And if you want an introduction to hand tools, this is ideal. So you can actually do this without creating any dust or noise in your leisure, and just keep creating these. So, and use them throughout the home and and door panels, furniture, just hanging off a Christmas tree or something. So what we could do is, so again, Kumiko is a centuries old Japanese technique of intricate patterns within a wood panel. Each pattern are also known as a motif. So the pattern or motif combines these small elements. These are beveled elements within the within each of the squares to form a, in this case, the asset. The panels are used throughout Japan as part of shoji screens. These are like room dividers, doors, and furniture. So the Kumiko aesthetic is designed to let light in and let light out. So it's a divider, but it's not a solid divider, and it lets a nice shadow effect on your... So I use it in cabinets, and I'll show you that in one of the upcoming slides. And my furniture, integrated and incorporated into my furniture to be able, for people to be able to view the contents, the art objects, the decorative objects within the cabinet, and the silhouette of the light is quite impressive, and I've had incredibly good feedback on it. So again, it's composed of a grid and short pieces attached with miters or bevels. And the outside grid is called the, what is it here? Jigumi. I don't use that terminology, but it's called, technically it's called, it's a Japanese term for a grid, square grid, and it's a jigumi. Now the reason I mentioned square grid is because you can actually have a diamond shape or not square grids, and the easiest one to create is a square grid because everything's at right angles. So that's what we're doing in this workshop series. And the hinge, I'm going to get into that in the slide, so we'll just, I won't get into that, but the, I guess we can start with the slides. So the so what I've got here is I've got a panel, I've got the Asanoha motif pattern in a square, and I'm it's surrounded by basswood blocks. These are half-inch basswood blocks that are sliced and form all the components, the outside grid and the inner components. The outside grids have notches in them to be able to create that pattern, interlocking pattern, and then the inside components, the diagonals or bevels, are all beveled by hand. So it's also another terminology widely used with Kumiko is this lattice-like pattern, and the joinery is half lap joints. I'm not sure if everybody's familiar with half lap joints, but they're half the width of the this is a half inch, so a quarter inch, and here I'll give a demonstration. This is the this is half lap, so this is a half inch piece that the grid is composed of, and this is the one of the other. So for example, if I'm interlocking a grid, I would just join the two pieces, and that's... Thanks, Matt.
You're very welcome.
Okay, next. So again, the bar stock is half inch thick because in my own work, I like to standardize everything. So I have a box full of spare parts here for Kumiko, and they're all standardized to a uniform spacing. Not just a uniform spacing, but a uniform width of half inch. And in this case, it's half an eighth of an inch. But Lee Valley sells kits now with bar stock at 5/32, which is 1/32 over what I normally use, but this is plenty to create a few of the Asanoha patterns. We're going to be using this in the workshop. And
so when you're, are you resawing all of your own pieces directly from a solid block of basswood?
Yes, you can either do it that way, Matt. I didn't bring the block in. I've got a fresh block now, and resaw to this piece here. Resaw and mill it down to half inch, and then work with this. Either create notches on a finger joint jig, which I'm going to be showing. And or using solid strips without notches for the inner components. So the basswood, the thick basswood block is reduced down to chunks of a half inch, and then we work with this. So you can see the half inch stock at the top for bars with the with the grooves and the then they're sliced. They're sliced down to the strips. So yeah. Actually, I did bring one that was pre-sawn. I just want to show you the what it looks like after it's gone through the finger joint jig, and this is the grooves.
Mm-hmm.
And then the and this is ultimately what it looks like. So you run it through, and the spacing, my own spacing is arbitrary, 2.75, but you can use anything. I just did this for standardization, so I can use all the parts for just create a bunch of parts and keep using them. So we can move on. So again, that basswood block, it's either reduced down to half inch, but then it's either notched at the top or solid for the inner component. So the notching is for the outside grid. So just give you an idea, that upper block, that would create about three patterns like this.
Oh wow.
Yeah, we need six pieces to create the outside grid. Now, this is a thicknessing sled, and once I've I hand planed I surfaced one edge of this board, the half inch thick board, and then I resaw it on a bandsaw, or you could use a table saw, down to a little bit over an eighth or 5/32 of an inch, and then I run that piece, and I've got a couple of raw ones here. They're a little bit oversized for thickness, mm-hmm. So you have a dress size,
yep.
And a thickness size, and I run it through this
the sled you made.
Thicknessing sled. Now it's got a spacer, and it's very versatile, but in this case it's set up for Kumiko. So I run it through, and I bring it, reduce it down to, so with the, that's just an idea of how it works. With the spacer, it automatically brings the thickness down to the predetermined 5/32 or 1/8. So I've been using 1/8, but it's very versatile. I've set it up for 5/32 now. So that works really well. Now, I just happen to be using this plane, but you can create this for any size plane. It's just most planes are a little bit wider. This one's narrow, mm-hmm. So this fits a couple of rabbits. So I'll leave that there. And then next, again, there's two or three slides that sort of break down this thicknessing sled. The rabbit, the block plane guides through the rabbits, and then the shim is removable, and I just keep adding tape or reducing the thickness with.
And that's how you're actually able to change the thickness.
Yes.
Of.
Yes.
Okay.
So it's set for anywhere between 8 and 5/32.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's nice. It's cool. Anyway. Okay. Next. So that sled is slides in there some is 3/4 inch Baltic birch for stability. And what I've also done is,
I think what people are, some people are asking us to speak a little louder.
Really?
We're speaking as
okay.
Well, so.
Some, what I've also done is I've customized it for my own workbench. So I have dog holes at the leading edge of my workbench. I'll just put this over here. And so this plugs into the dog holes.
And they just happen to fit perfectly here.
Yep. So I have the same workbench. Just a bit of trickery there.
Awesome.
Just make sure to get the same workbench.
Yeah.
Actually, it fits better here. Now, if it doesn't fit and you've only got one dog hole, what I found is you can actually just install it in one dog hole. Just tilt it and just.
Yeah.
So even if the spacing is not quite the same. So what I'll do is I'll move this over. And this for now. The next slide. So between the finger joint jig and the thicknessing sled, we have notched strips on the left and solid strips on the right. They're a half inch wide, and again, I put some specifications in, but the spacing is arbitrary, so I've set them at 2.75, and I've always done it that way just to be able to mass produce this. And my nominal thickness has always been 1/8, but it can easily be brought up to 5/32 or even a quarter inch for the outside grid. So now we're today, in this workshop series, we're working with 5/32, which is the Lee Valley kit next. So now we're getting into the meat. The square itself is called the Jigumi. The Kumiko grids are created from the bars we've just created. Half lap joints lock things together. And actually, I've got. So the half lap joints again, they lock everything together.
Mm-hmm.
And some glue applied to the outside. And the reason we apply glue is eventually, once we've completed this and applied some little glue on the outside, we can cut off these ears. And the ears are just there to be able to reinforce the ends, so when you lock it in, it doesn't snap off. So the eventually this looks like, this square looks like this without the ears. So we do that, and then some more specifications next. So this is a diagram of a breakdown of the actual Asanoa pattern. And so again, the Jigumi square forms the outside grid with the 2 3/4 inch spacing. I think there's 6 components to create the outside grid and the 2 center components. Now all the bevel components, I've broken them down here into, they're all broken down into angles. So if you notice the color coded them, the white strips are called diagonals and the ends are at 45 degrees on either end. So they snap in. Here's an example of here's a 45 degree. And this is the, so I just removed it from here. So this would block in here after it's fitted. That's white. Now, once that's done, we create the wings. There are 16 wings, the red parts. And that's a little more involved because they have different angles where they join. And the outside, they're 22 and a half. And the inside angles are 67 and a half. And they're beveled, but 1/3 and 2/3.
Okay.
So the 1/3 part, I'm going to coming an upcoming slide on that. The 1/3 part is where they join, and the 67 and a half outside part creates a. Just raised that. So this little piece is the. Now, can we go back? The blue part, the little piece is the blue part, and it's a short locking piece, and it's got 45 degree angles at either end. So you can see the blue part actually locks in the 2 red parts. So it sounds complex and everything, but when you've done 1 and 2 or 3 or 4, it's just a matter of replicating over and over, and it becomes easy. So that's what that is. Okay, move ahead. Now, this is detail of the center part. So the locking key again is at 45 degrees at either end. Now that center part, the 2 wings where they come together, the angle is 67 and a half. And I've noted 1/3, 2/3. If you notice, there's a 1/3 bevel on one facet and 2/3 on the other facet. And the narrower facet, the 1/3 facet is where the wings join. And then the 2/3 facet is where the locking key goes in. And go back. Okay, now you're probably wondering why these angles, and I asked myself this a long time ago, because 67 and a half degrees subtracted from 90 is 22 and a half, and 22 and a half is half of 45. So if you look at the 67 and a half degree angle, it works well with 45 because you've got 2 on the outside where the locking key fits in.
Yeah.
It's two 22 and a half degree openings create a 45 degree for the locking key, and it just works out. Now the locking key, 67 and a half degree, wings. Yes, we can move on. So to create Kumiko, patience is key because you're doing a lot of handwork and a little detail work with chisels and fine tooth backsaws. It's important to use sharp chisels. And actually all your woodworking or all your craft work, always use sharp chisels that slice fibers instead of tearing them. You'll find you need less effort with a sharp chisel, less likely to cut yourself, and never have a hand in front of the chisel hand. So whenever you're working, never have a hand there. And I demonstrate that. So we're using basswood to create these all the components for the Asanoha. And basswood is a traditional wood used for this because it's a hardwood. It's considered a hardwood, but it compresses and it's a very forgiving wood. So even though sometimes the joint is even slightly oversized or something, it'll actually compress in, unlike other hardwoods. So once you become more comfortable with this, you can move on to maple or even poplar. Poplar is another good wood. It's kind of a soft hardwood. But maple is hard and it's not forgiving, so you need a little more accuracy. But basswood I've always used, and it's a light wood, so it contrasts well with darker woods. Have sufficient lighting to see the detail, and practice safety when using a sharp chisel. As I mentioned, there's a circular motion on chisels, and we'll get into that, because again, never have your alternate hand in front of the chisel when you're working, because you can easily, the chisel can escape, and bad results. So this is a finger joint jig. There's two ways of creating two methods of creating the notches and the strips and the bars, either with a finger joint jig or manually. We're going to be doing it manually here with a small Kumiko bench hook. And the finger joint jig is nothing but a 3-inch tall, in this case, Baltic birch. You could use MDF as illustrated in the photo, and it has an indexing pin. So this indexing pin is dialed into 1/8 inch thick, because it conforms to the thickness of a standard saw blade. So if you're using a narrow curved blade, you might have to reduce that or try to use a standard size blade. And then the idea is to create your very first notch using the finger joint jig along the blade, and then move it along so that notch in the opening is 2 3/4 inch spacing, and just keep going along. So the important thing is to determine the spacing you need and then work from there. But you can see this particular finger joint jig I've used for quite a few operations, and I'm doing I'm doubling up on the grids now. So you'll notice a little extra slot there for that. So it's very versatile and easy to create or reproduce. So that's that technique on the table saw. Well, what we're going to be using is the bench hook. This is a versatile bench hook, but it specifically for Kumiko for the height. If you can recreate this with a taller fence. This is the fence. This is a stop block, and the base, and the cleat. And what the cleat does is places it against the bench, so because you're working forward here, so it doesn't go any further. And then the nice thing about this is if you remove the stop block, you can just flip it over, and you can either have different settings here. You can have mitered settings, yeah. And install the stop block, or just recreate another one. It took 15 minutes to make this, yeah. So it's not a big deal. And then we use these little bar clamps, these brass bar clamps, we're going to be creating these notches on the bench hook. Okay, and the bench hook. So we line them up against the predetermined slots, again at 2 2 3/4 inch apart, and then we clamp them, and we saw, and then we offset them a little, and that creates that little notch. And the notch itself is 1/4 inch down, mm-hmm. So it's a half lap. For all the non-woodworkers out there, it's a half lap joint, so this is 1/2 the thickness, so the width, sorry. So it's 1/4 inch, and this is 1/2 inch. So that's what you need to work from there. So that's a little more a breakdown of the actual bench hook, the fence, We're going to be, when we create the bench truck, we're going to be attaching the fence and the cleat and creating the parts to the base. You can use, this is a half inch thick base, but created one with 3/4, whatever you have available. You don't even need to use Baltic birch, you can use MDF, any scrap wood you have in your workshop. And this is an example of Kumiko in a furniture piece. I made so far 3 furniture pieces incorporating Kumiko, this specific Asanoa pattern. I'm working on a 4th one now. So this is it's quite popular because people have never seen this before. It's a more of a traditional Japanese technique, and it's only now being introduced into the West and integrated into, incorporated into furniture.
It's beautiful.
So it's the light basswood contrasts very well with dark woods, and it allows light to enter and exit the piece.
That's gorgeous.
Yeah.
You can see in the example here that Norm has made as well, where it's using the basswood, and then the mahogany on the exterior looks fantastic.
Yeah, the goal of the workshop is to recreate this with either cherry or a darker wood, so it contrasts with the grid and the Asanoa pattern, and that's an example. So I had what I had lying around at the time, but I normally use cherry, you know. And
I'm excited.
Yeah,
this is amazing.
What kind of questions do we have?
Yeah, we're gonna go back to the Facebook questions, and if there's any questions here, we'll get back to them, and Norman will be able to answer them for you. We do know that there were some issues where we weren't speaking loud enough, so we do apologize for that, and hopefully you can hear us a little better now, and we'll do our best to make sure that that the quality of the sound, the audio is perfect. So Tony has a great question here. Can other hardwoods like maple be used?
Yes, most definitely, but basswood, again, is forgiving, so I tend to use basswood, but you could use maple. You just have to be a little more, the joiner has to be a little more critical in accuracy and precision, because it isn't as forgiving. It doesn't compress, is another word for forgiving. So I tend to use basswood. Poplar is a good wood. You can even use darker woods. You can actually use cherry. But these woods are easy to slice with a chisel too, these lighter woods, unlike maple and harder woods. So I would start with, if you're just learning, I would definitely start with the basswood, strips or the kit, and then move on from there. Yeah, not a good idea to move in to start learning this with hard woods like maple.
William is asking, or is also asking us, what is the depth of jig bed without, and are you using any shims, without any shims?
Which jig bed, the thicknessing?
I wonder if it would be that one or the thicknessing maybe.
Yeah, probably the thicknessing. I've got it. I'd say about 3/4, half an inch of depth. Well, you can use, if you're, if I remove the shim, the complete shim, which is, you know, you can make any shim you want, it's about 1/2 inch deep below the surface of the sole of the block plane, and the length is arbitrary. So I really, really created this for thicknessing Kumiko strips or bars, but I've begun using it for almost all my work. It's on my workbench at all times now. it's very, very versatile.
So Andy Williams is asking, how does the humidity or the lack of humidity affect the joints in Kumiko?
It's another benefit of using basswood is that the humidity or moisture in your home doesn't affect it as much, because I've created furniture pieces, and they've been out there in different environments for a year or two now, and nothing's impacted them. And but if you feel that you have humidity fluctuations, severe ones, I would just put a dab of glue in the joint, and that's not going to, because they're so small, there's no issue at all with wood movement. I think you're referring to wood movement. Yeah.
So Philip is also asking us, do you have a table saw jig for larger production or hardwoods?
No. The only jig I use is to create on a table saw is to create the notches to create the finger joint jig and create the bar stock to create the notched pieces. Oh, here's a small, this is a leftover. This is probably 6 inches wide at one point or 8 inches. This is a leftover piece. So I would dress once one edge and then slice an oversized piece and then finish it on the thicknessing jig, reduce it down to a specific eighth inch or 5/32nds, and then slice another piece and go from there.
That's very handy. William, I agree. I think it's something that actually I'll be building for my shop as well.
Really?
So that's
thicknessing?
Yeah, that's very handy. So once again, we do apologize for the audio that some of you seem to have had issues with before. As we're working forward here, if you do happen to have any other questions, feel free to ask us. Actually, we see another couple there. Are the jig from Travis, are the jig dimensions and drawings going to be available? We'll do our best to have something available for you after the presentation is done. Gareth is also asking, how do you cut the angled pieces or the ends of the interior pieces?
Yeah, that's actually the next session coming up, the beveled, the mitered pieces. And I'll have to introduce guide blocks at that point. I've got some here, but I'm not sure if anybody wants to see them. But
so, Gareth, you'll have to come back.
Stay tuned to come
for
back.
For the second piece of this.
Yeah, we introduced the, today we're creating the outer grid, and then subsequent sessions we're going to be filling it in with the mitered pieces.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Luke, the same goes for you as well. If you log in and watch us with the next live stream, we'll be actually starting on cutting the angles. And as Norman was saying, we're going to be starting with the exterior grid today, and we'll go from there.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I'm going to be, how do you feel? Do you want to use the pre-cut strips?
I'm here to learn.
Yeah.
Happy
so what
to do
we'll
it
do anyway. Is we'll do both.
Sure.
This is a rough strip I've created from I had a large thick bass block. I didn't bring it in or anything, but then I reduced it down to half inch, and then I dress one size like you mentioned, because it's easier on a block.
Yep.
And then so that's a reference surface, and then then I dress it again. Cut. So you need a total of because of this length. This is 18 inches long. We only need three strips at three bars.
Okay.
Because the bars are then sliced in half, and each bar will form one of the sides or the end component. The sides are this cross of the SNOA pattern. So what I'll do is I'll slice this down to size. I'll measure it. So I think I had a tape measure somewhere.
So we do have a couple other questions here. So Bob is asking us, how do you calculate the length of the red and blue interior pieces so that the angles described match?
Very, very good question. We're going to get into that, not in this session, but
stay tuned.
Yeah, it's a little bit of skill to that. And when you've done it once, then it's straightforward afterwards.
So we've just posted as well that you can join us on November 10th at 12 for part two, where Norman will be covering the second part on how to cut the angles. So right now in this first session, we're just going to be working on the exterior grid. And then for session two on the 10th of November, we'll be cutting some angles.
Yeah, so assuming you have these pieces sliced, or you purchased the kit already set to 5/32nds, and you don't have to do this. So this is 18 inches long, and we'll cut this down to 9. And you know what? I don't have a pencil. Where's that pencil? We'll cut this down to 9. By the way, I use, I like to advertise this ruler. This is a hook rule, and I've been using this for over 20 years. I have two or three of these. This is the best invention ever, because it hooks over a piece. So if you can get one of these, I mean, it's carried. It's a Lee Valley product, but it's a hook rule, and it's amazing because it hooks over, and the accuracy, no need to guesstimate on where the end is. It just transfers easily. So we'll I'll cut this down to size. So what we're doing, Matt, is we're slicing this in half.
Okay.
And so the I haven't talked much about the bench hook, but the bench hook has we're going to be using it to create the notches in the individual pieces. And at the far left end of the bench hook is a through cut. So what this is it's used specifically as a bench hook. Then you talk to Miko, so you can cut parts down to size, mm-hmm. up to a half inch high. So I'll use I'm using this back saw Dazuki, and it's marketed as a rip saw, but it works very well as a crosscut saw. You're probably wondering, rip saw, crosscut, but it works really well as a crosscut saw. Fine, the fine component is there, and I'll just so just careful not to cut into the base too much. So now we have two strips, and so what I'll do next is I'll demonstrate the thicknessing guide. Is this visible? If I place it here. Is it visible now? Okay. So
you're going to use your jig again just to take those down to the same thickness?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay.
I think I've got it set for 1/8, so I have to actually measure from time to time. You want to try this, Matt?
Sure.
Go ahead. Oh, yeah, I'm left-handed. So. Just, oh, there we go. Yeah.
So have you waxed the outer rails on your jig here?
Not this part, maybe this part a long time ago.
Okay.
But I usually wax. I usually apply wax to the actual
sole.
It's a tight fit, but it doesn't seem to have worn. I've had this for,
it's amazing,
2 or 3 years now. The same jig. So periodically we'll take a measurement. Where is that ruler?
Just under your door over there.
It is?
Yeah, just in the.
Oh yeah, there it is. So we're striving for 5/30 seconds, and we're at just below 6/30 seconds now. So I made them oversized just for a demonstration. I normally go a little tighter, so
okay.
There's less.
Once you have cleaned up your first face, do you flip it and work on the other side, or do you just stay the one?
No, because it's a reference.
Okay.
You can actually mark them if it's.
Yeah.
You know, the beauty of Kumiko is they're not like creating dovetails or precision work. It's really, you don't need to be that precise. Like, even if the surfaces are not maybe 90% parallel to each other, it's fine. Or 95%.
So Norman is saying that we don't have to be very precise, but I think I beg to differ. Looks amazing. I don't know how that's going to come together.
Almost there. So normally I worked a little bit faster, but for demonstration purposes, I'm just slowing down here. And also, depending on the amount of coffee I've had.
Yeah.
So
it's the way I work as well.
Okay, we're at almost 5:30 seconds. Actually, what we could do is compare this to these presets already. Since these are already cut. Hey, bang on. Okay. So that's so I've created one strip. Using the other process of cutting it from a large basswood block. This is one small strip, and then we'll. Do you want to do six of these, or?
Yeah, we could. Daniel's asking, do you have any favorite patterns for Kumiko?
It's a good question. Until recently, I've only been making this Sasanoa pattern. I've dabbled in other patterns, and this. what I've done is, I've. Just to challenge myself, as I mentioned earlier, I love to challenge myself. I've doubled up on the grid. It's a little more aesthetically pleasing. So if you notice, the grid we're going to be making is a single grid, and this is a double grid. So it's just a second set of notches, and you need four more pieces to be able to create this. Mm-hmm. So a total of 10 pieces instead of six. But that's a little more interesting.
Yeah,
but
beautiful.
the inner pattern or motif has always been Asanoa. And this, I just brought in one other example of the Yatsuba pattern. And this is quite interesting from the feedback I've received so far. So this is actually just as simple to make as this. You know, not simple, right?
Yeah.
But it's different. So when you get tired of one, you can make the other. So do you want to continue with that?
Sure.
That's your student. Make sure it doesn't escape from the stop. You shouldn't have a problem with this one. So because we've already measured this, the easiest way without the ruler, once you've done one, is just to work, just to, so it's still thick. Go ahead. When using this thicknessing jig, you'll find that eventually you actually you just count the number of shavings, and you can actually dial in, so you know that you've got four and one more. You've run that block plane along four times, and then you know exactly.
The same.
Yeah, that's okay now. So that's that. Now just to accelerate this, I think we're. Quarter to one already. We're going to be using these strips. Okay.
So we have one more question here. What are the intended purpose of these? They're beautiful. Just wondering if they have any purpose or if they're just decorative.
Yes. the purpose is the original purpose for this is widely used in Japan for screens on a larger scale. In that case. They tend to use portable room dividers in Japan. They just have one large space and they don't have hard walls, so they move screens around. But to let some light in, they tend to use this technique, these patterns between on the shoji screens, but also on furniture. And so it's purely really decorative, functional in Japan, but or in my case, in the furniture. The other thing you can do with this is apply rice paper on one side. It's another something just to bring it up a notch. Is apply rice paper and light and illuminate from either the outside or the inside, and that's quite dramatic too.
So William does have a good question here. He says, so you plane only one side of the plank. I guess the teeth on the saw are fine enough that you don't need to plane out the marks.
Yes.
And we also have Lawrence asking us, where can the patterns be located? Do Lee Valley have them?
Well, Lee Valley has a book out. I forget the title, but I've been using this book, Shoji and Kumiko Design, Book 1, Basics by Desmond King. He's quite renowned in the world of Kumiko. So I've been using him, his book to reference for all the different patterns. But there's so many patterns out there, they're not even in the whole book.
So Julie's also asking, if you were using an accent in the standard 3/4 inch thick cabinet doors, do you adjust the thickness from half to maybe 5/8?
Yes. Yeah. Again, going back to the scale, this scale is small, so we can create smaller jigs and everything smaller because it's lighter and smaller. But for large screens and a door, that book covers that well, actually. He makes large-scale furniture, large-scale doors with incorporating Kumiko, and they're much larger, maybe an inch or an inch and a half, or two inches.
Wow. So I think we have Daniel is also asking, I'm just wondering if you think I could get away with using my table saw now for the thicknessing?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you can create the strips on a table saw. If you just determine if the faces are clean, And if you need to clean them up with a block plane, just place the strip along a, you don't even need a thicknessing jig, just place it along a stop and run one pass, just clean it up.
Corey and Nicole, if you do get around to making the floor lamp with the rice paper motif, post it when you're done back into the feed here. So mm-hmm. Once we're done, the feed will still be up on Facebook, so you'll be able to post those so that we can see them. That'd be beautiful.
Yeah. Shall we go ahead and I'll...
Yes, let's do this.
So, I'm only... we have time constraints here, I think. I'm only going to be ganging up two. Okay. So normally, on the bench hook for the Kumiko, I gang up six of these strips, and the six strips form that grid, the outside grid.
Exterior grid.
Yeah, so these are 5/32. So we're only going to be using two just for demonstration purposes. So I align two up, and I use these small brass bar clamps.
Mm-hmm.
To
hold them nice and snug.
Yeah. It's better this way, this way. Okay. This way. It's cool.
So we have another question from William. He said he's seen garden lanterns that were round with Kumiko patterns inside these windows. And he's wondering if the book happens to cover any of that.
It's a good question. I've never actually... Which book? I'm only...
Probably the one you just showed there.
No, that book is more for the origins of Kumiko and how to incorporate in a large scale work.
Okay.
And all the different patterns and specific angles. But that second book that was mentioned, I think, probably has that. Or you can find it on the internet, worst case. Not that I ever look at the internet. So what we're going to be doing, Matt, is I'm going to be using this saw,
okay,
that's mentioned in the tools, and we're going to be, we're going to be marking this off for carrying that measurement over. And normally I put a pencil mark to spacing, but I've come up with another way to do this. And we want depths. These are half inch wide. We want a depth of 1/4 inch deep. So we're going to be sawing down to 1/4 inch. I should have marked that off.
So Dwight was just asking, where do we find those little clamps, those little brass clamps?
Lee Valley.
So
yeah,
Dwight,
it's in the parts, I think.
We do sell the clamps here at Lee Valley, so we'll be posting those shortly. And you can definitely get them there.
Yep. Just back this off a bit. So I use this measuring gun and I bring it down to 1/4 inch.
Okay.
There's a little bit flexibility with this 1/4 inch mark. And you want to do this on each of the measurements. Don't forget, you're doing six of these at a time normally.
Mm-hmm.
So, move this over here. So these strips, normally six, but we got two here. They're against the stop block and then the saw. So we make the first initial cut. Try not to cut my tools. Down to 1/4 inch. This is quarter inch. I'm gonna do the same here. You can do a third one.
Sure.
I'll just move this over. So is there a line there? Yeah.
Yep.
So just lightly, very, very, very. Try to keep it straight.
Yep.
Oh, sorry there. Okay. That's good. Now, so we've created the, we've done that. So we just back off the little bar clamps, the brass bar clamps. And then to create the second one, I formerly was marking them, and it's a little complex. So what I've done is I've created a little spacer. This spacer is just a little bit over an eighth of an inch, so it's 4/32, and this so we slide that in.
I was wondering how we were going to do that.
Yeah. Well, originally I was marking them on, but it gets complicated. So okay. So let's see if that works.
So Daniel's asking us, how resilient is basswood for outdoor applications? Lanterns, chairs, whatnot.
Oh, not at all. I wouldn't use it outdoors, no. I never heard of being used in an outdoor application. Probably want to use cedar. Cedar is a nice wood too. I forget to mention that for soft. It's a,
yeah,
it's a soft wood. So we'll cut the other part of the opening down.
Sure.
Just make sure it's straight. And the horizontal. Okay. This one down to just a quarter inch. Okay. So we've done that. Now we leave everything clamped. You might want to use, two sufficient. So what we're going to do now, let's get that chisel. This is a 1/8 inch wide chisel. I've got another one. Should we use mine or this one? Let's use this one.
Sure.
And then, so the idea is to notch them out.
According to Cole, there isn't, as of right now, a kit that could be put together for this, apart from the wood lattice work, or in addition to the wood lattice work. But I think that we could definitely put together for the presentation here, the different tools that we were using and links to them. I think that we've been doing that as we've been speaking. So I think that if you go through the conversations here, you'll be able to actually see that what Norman is using has been available through the website. And so Alan is also wondering, so the spacer is just slightly wider than the thickness of the 6-inch pieces.
No, the length. It's just
it's just offsetting.
It just offsets the the bars. I can't remove it now, but it just offsets the bars so I can open this notch up. So I create both sides of the notch.
Yeah.
You see I've already cleared this out with the chisel.
So it doesn't take much with the basswood.
No. And you want to go as just as far down as the line. So I'll do this one or this one. You can do the middle one.
That's the one I messed up.
Why did you mess it up?
I'm not too sure.
Here, I'm gonna have to fail you.
Yeah.
It's not messed up. A little bit cleaner normally, but you want to do the middle one.
Sure.
It's really, really, you have to be straight and try to be as straight as possible. Just to not just to stir here.
A little bit higher?
Yeah. Okay, just push. Lift. So again, that spacer is arbitrary. I've picked an eighth of an inch, but you could try to make it between 5/32 or closer to the 5/32 spacer. My next one will probably be a little bit wider. I notice it's a little tight, because my own chisel is a little bit different. So now we remove the clamps, and so you can see the notches have all been created,
mm-hmm.
except for this one, and then.
So I guess if they're not a perfect half lap, you would just put it back in and just remove.
Yeah, it's not wide enough. Yep. So we should do that then.
So patience is key.
Yeah, what happened is my spacer is a little bit too narrow. Should use a slightly thicker one.
Mm-hmm.
What I'll do is I'll just cut this. So just offset them about a 32nd now. I'm going to clean that cut out. Okay. You know what? Let's do something different. Let's reorient these. We've got three new pieces. So
Gina's just commented as well. It says, glad you picked this project. Great Japanese craft. If you decide to mass produce certain patterns, would you set up a template jigs with the measurements and cuts already built in to speed things up?
You could do that. I've essentially done that because if you notice earlier I mentioned I had a 2 3/4 inch spacing between the notches. So I've essentially done that. So I have a box full of spare parts here I can use for all this is just over the year or two. Right? So this is an idea of, I just wanted to confirm that yes, they do fit together at some point. So that's how they should fit. They should just plug right in. Because I normally use an eighth of an inch. But.
So William is wondering here, could you not use a bit of your Kumiko plank as the spacer on the end? That way the offset would be exactly the thickness of the half lap, perhaps a bit narrower?
That's a good point, because actually I did that and I found it to be a little wide. So it depends on how we're cutting. So maybe closer to 5/32nd. This is a little bit narrow. I didn't have anything wider. But
and then David is also wondering, if it is too tight, could we not plane down the thickness a little on those?
I wouldn't do that because, yes, you could, but you need to plane down all six to make it all uniform. You could easily do that too. But then, you know, again, standardization and simplicity. This is not a... You know, to be honest with you, I've never had this problem. So I'll just do this again. Just eyeball the depth. And I'm going to, this time I'll bring it over. And I will use one of those strips. Where's the 5/32nd piece? Cut this off. I'll create a 5/32nd spacer and use this. So this is actually this spacer, theoretically 5/32nd is the actual width of the notch, so it should work a lot better. Let's do it that way. Let's bring it over. Did you want to do one?
Sure. Sure.
Okay, just halfway. And then one more. And then this one's already both ends have been cut, so we can use that same technique you were using, Matt, with the chisel.
Okay.
Just bring that up. Works a little better.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Let's see how that. Yeah, this one hasn't been cut.
Yeah, cut yet.
But yeah, that's
it's too loose.
A little bit too loose. So the solution is to have something between this and this, between the eighth and the 5/32. You know what the problem is? Just maybe this isn't even an eighth. It's just below an eighth. That's the problem. I thought it was an eighth.
Okay.
So if you bring it a little bit over a little,
because you want it to be the same thickness as your chisel.
Yes. Yeah. Well, the chisel is theoretically it's an eighth of 4/32,
okay.
And these notches should be 5/32 because of this width, but it works well just the same because that basswood again is compressed. But spacing was the issue. The spacing, because it's 1/8, is a little bit too narrow,
okay,
for the 5/32, and the 5/32 spacer is a little bit too wide, so somewhere in between.
So Rob here has made a good point. It should be a little too wide now because we'd have to subtract the width of the blade itself.
And that's exactly why I selected, good point.
Just under the...
Rob, that's why I selected 1/8 because of the kerf of the saw blade. Forgot to mention that. We're compensating for the extra kerf, the kerf of the saw blade. The saw blade itself creates, I think it's 0.014 or something for this saw. once you've created this this bench hook, and you created the spacer, you can use the spacer forever. So it's just a matter of dialing in the spacer for 5/32. Again, I've really only been ever using 1/8 of an inch because they just interlock. Mm-hmm. So this is what I use normally. But 5/32, just a matter of setting things up for 5/32. So this should be between 1/8 inch or 4/32 and 5/32. So I don't know what that is. 4/32 is 5/32. Must be something. What is it?
4/32.
1/64. In the 1/64 now. So.
So I think what we're going to do today, Norman, is we'll wrap it up here, and then what we'll do is the second part to this will be on November 10th at 12. So by then, what we'll do is we'll have a couple of these cut. We'll have our thicknesses all sorted out and everything else, and we'll be able to start working, I guess, on the exterior frame. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll start to work on cutting the angles and the other pieces. We've also just posted that the third session will take part on November 16th at 12, and the fourth part, we're actually making the bench hook for this, will take place on December 1st at 12. So if you follow us for the next three sessions as well, you will end up with making something like this, which is truly amazing. Yep. And
we're hoping to actually create the outer frame too.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Good. I'm looking forward to that. So what we'll do is, if you did happen to have any other questions, you can reply to the Facebook feed here as well, and we'll go through and we'll answer those as we can. You can always continue to message there. Stay tuned for the second, third, and fourth portion of this the seminar. And like I said, we'll be finishing with one of these Kumiko patterns. And so this is Norman. So I'm Matt, and we've had a great day with you guys so far. So follow us next time. And if you happen to have any questions, you can always reach out to us at socials@leevalley.com, and we'll go from there. Do you have anything else to...
Yeah.
wrap up with?
No, I'll get this spacer short sorted out, and I'll have a slightly larger, wider. this is just below an eighth, so I should have a little bit over an eighth next time.
We'll blame these all on me, and I'm happy to take the blame for this. And
it always works until Matt's here.
That's it. People have said that before.
Really?
Yeah. Anyways, we'll leave it there. So thank you guys very much for following along with the live stream today, and we'll see you soon. Have a wonderful day. Thank you. Take care.